Welcome back to 12 Days in March. In this section, we forge ahead, leaving the mitral valve and those delicious derivatives behind. The next two videos will address LV outflow obstruction as the paradigm for aortic stenosis and hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So here are the aortic valve disorders: aortic stenosis, which is the focus of this video, and aortic regurgitation or insufficiency. The terms are used interchangeably. The location of aortic stenosis is described at the right upper sternal border, which is also referred to as the base. The murmur typically radiates to the carotids. In fact, failure to radiate implies the degree of stenosis is not severe, or you have the wrong murmur. It is a systolic murmur, which is intuitive as blood flows past the aortic valve during LV contraction. When a murmur correlates with LV contraction, it is typically pretty loud, as I also highlighted in our discussion of mitral regurgitation. Let's look at this graphically as well. As stated, aortic stenosis is heard best at the right upper sternal border. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, as you can see, is noted at the left sternal border and is commonly described by exam maneuvers and/or a description of an outflow gradient. These two murmurs are described as creating LV outflow obstruction. Focusing just on aortic stenosis, the murmur may also be described at the base of the heart. Rather than struggling to understand why this is considered the base of the heart, I simply highlight the location of the cardiac apex. I think we are all comfortable with this region being identified as the apex. If we can comfortably identify this region as the apex, it is easier then to identify this region as the base of the heart. Nothing fancy here, just a word of clarification and some beautiful images. And while we are taking in the anatomic landmarks, we can also see how the aortic stenosis murmur will be described as radiating to the carotids. The carotids are just up the road a bit. In terms of the quality of the murmur, it carries this characteristic description of crescendo decrescendo. But what does this mean? I've snuck in this image from the cardiac cycle curve we'll review momentarily, but it gives a physiologic sense of why this is described by crescendo decrescendo. The crescendo correlates with the increasing volume of blood flowing past the narrow aortic valve aperture during rapid ejection. As the LV pressure begins to diminish in late systole, that is, while calcium reuptake is occurring in the cardiac myocytes, the amount of blood flowing past the narrowed aperture diminishes. This diminished volume of blood correlates with the decrescendo portion of the murmur. The conclusion of this event is marked by S2, that is, aortic valve closure. As an important clinical FYI, the intensity of S2 does correlate with the severity of aortic stenosis. That is, if S2 is normal in intensity, the likelihood of critical aortic stenosis is diminished. And just to reiterate two points I've made about the exam. If the murmur fails to radiate to the carotids, and the intensity of the aortic component of S2 is described as normal, you can effectively exclude the presence of severe or critical aortic stenosis. Whereas these underscore key components of the exam, this is not step one fodder, but is a recurrent theme in clinical medicine. Before launching this discussion, I need to once again remind you that the NBME describes patients with abnormal auscultatory findings. They assume you know the murmurs and then they launch the derivatives. You can't get the derivatives without identifying the valvular disorder that is causing the abnormal physical exam finding. So step one is to identify the stated murmur. And finally, before launching into the details, here is a summary of the key points we will be discussing. First, be familiar with the association of aortic stenosis with the congenital bicusp, and have an awareness that congenital bicusp is one of the two cardiac manifestations associated with Turner syndrome, with the other being coarctation. Next, I think you can appreciate that the obstructive physiology gives rise to LVH, specifically described by the phrase concentric hypertrophy. We will ultimately contrast this with the eccentric hypertrophy associated with aortic insufficiency and the asymmetric septal hypertrophy of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And following from the obstructive physiology will be derivatives related to the increased afterload. Aortic stenosis will stand out as the prototypic condition associated with increased afterload, and it is there where we will begin our discussion of the key hemodynamic derivatives associated with aortic stenosis. So here again is the LV pressure volume curve. As mentioned in the first video of the series, it isn't going away and becomes a key component of the language of aortic stenosis. Let's just focus on this portion of the curve for a moment. Recall, this curve reflects changes in volume at any given pressure. Normally, we have isovolumetric contraction occurring until the pressure in the LV exceeds the diastolic pressure in the aorta. Once the pressure generated during isovolumetric contraction exceeds the aortic pressure, the aortic valve opens, followed by rapid ejection of blood from the left ventricle. But think about what occurs when the left ventricle has to generate excessive pressure to open a stenotic valve. For sure, this results in an elevation in afterload, but more importantly, the contractile forces no longer need to overcome the diastolic pressures in the aorta to open the aortic valve. Instead, they need to overcome resistance caused by the narrow aperture of the stenotic valve. So how does that affect the pressure volume curve? And here is the key pictorial derivative. The stenotic valve ultimately opened, but at a higher LV pressure. The LV pressure had to overcome the resistance of the stenotic valve, not the diastolic pressure of blood in the aorta. Awareness of this curve is the first key derivative. And in viewing this graphic, there is an obvious difference from the normal curve. You can see that the stroke volume has decreased. So derivative number two is why. Why has the stroke volume decreased? And here comes the language of afterload. As the sarcomere has to contract against increased resistance, both the velocity and distance shortened are decreased. This is the basis for the decreased stroke volume. Whereas this is admittedly low yield, it is certainly fair game for a physiology derivative on test day. There's no reason to give away simple and intuitive derivatives. Velocity and distance are affected by afterload. And here is the next key derivative. Afterload impacts cardiac work. Normally, the key determinant of cardiac work is aortic pressure. In aortic stenosis, however, forcing the valve open generates an increased workload for the left ventricle. And the logical derivative from this increased cardiac workload is an increase in myocardial oxygen demand. This is not so good in a patient struggling to perfuse the coronary vessels. So any of these derivatives are fair game on test day. These are the language of afterload. And although we focused on aortic stenosis as the prototypic disease of afterload, the principles also apply to malignant hypertension. However, malignant hypertension questions usually focus on vascular pathology and/or treatment, which is a good introduction to the next slide. So before leaving the LV pressure volume curve, let's compare and contrast the increased afterload curve with the decreased afterload curve. This actually drives home a couple of key points. First, the prototypic decreased afterload curve is seen with the use of nitroprusside, which happens to be the treatment of choice for malignant hypertension on step one. Jot that down somewhere. The reason it is the treatment of choice on step one is all the great nitroprusside derivatives, including this pressure volume curve. But truth told, the complication of cyanide toxicity is much more sexy. Who wouldn't love a cardiac drug that can cause cyanide toxicity? But that is a topic for another day. Now, where was I? Oh, yeah. Look at the decreased afterload curve. It highlights all the properties, but opposite of that seen in aortic stenosis. With decreased afterload, the velocity and distance of sarcomere shortening is increased, translating into an increase in stroke volume. There is a corresponding decrease in cardiac work and myocardial oxygen consumption. The curve on the right is a happy heart, a heart that doesn't mind coming to work each day. It is just easier to work when there is less resistance, and I think we would all agree to that. Moving on, here is our cardiac cycle curve. Recall, we are focused on the LV pressure in this discussion. Based on our previous discussions, let's focus on where and when the AV valve opens in a patient with stenosis. And here is what the aortic stenosis pressure curve looks like. The valve opens at a higher pressure. Just to be clear, this graphic is a high-yield derivative. They will describe the classic murmur, and you will need to choose the cardiac cycle curve correlating with a murmur or where the valve actually opens. And just for consistency, I've added a couple of arrows to again highlight the decrease in stroke volume associated with that delay in valve opening. We can again view the physiologic correlate of the crescendo-decrescendo systolic murmur, and we can grab another derivative associated with this curve, that being the point of peak murmur intensity. If we simply look at the point with maximal blood flow, we'll be able to identify our point of peak murmur intensity. All right, moving away from the hemodynamics, we can focus on the clinical correlates and their pathophysiologic derivatives. Listed are the classic symptoms associated with aortic stenosis. These include sudden cardiac death, angina, syncope, and congestive heart failure. You won't really see many questions on the association of aortic stenosis and sudden cardiac death. In fact, if the patient experiences sudden cardiac death in a vignette with a loud systolic murmur, more likely than not, it is a case of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. What you will see, however, is angina. This will be a pretty straightforward patho-anatomic correlate. You have a stenotic valve, and it is difficult to negotiate blood beyond it. Yet, you need to perfuse the coronary vessels. So where are the ostia for those blood vessels located? Answer, right above the aortic valve. Pretty straightforward. What about syncope? This is a big deal for a couple of reasons. However, before getting wed to the syncope discussion, be aware the NBME takes liberties in the description of obstructive symptoms. So they will describe an old buck with a 2 over 6 crescendo decrescendo murmur at the base radiating to the carotids. But rather than describing syncope, he might be described by lightheadedness or dizziness. These are possible variants on the obstructive symptom of syncope. So the excitement of syncope as an obstructive symptom lies in the differential diagnosis. And here is the key differential diagnosis, aortic stenosis versus hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. They present you with a 35-year-old dude with a 2 over 6 systolic murmur who passes out. You narrow it down to aortic stenosis versus hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but how will you know the correct answer? In these questions, you will need to focus on what they tell you as well as what they don't tell you. Here are the key characteristics of a patient with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. They will generally have a family history of sudden cardiac death, or the syncopal episode will be during an athletic event. More likely than not, they'll include physical exam maneuvers. If they don't give you these typical identifiers, more likely than not, your syncopal patient would have aortic stenosis secondary to a congenital bicusp. What they tell you and what they don't. And finally, CHF. Clinically, other than the murmur, this is probably the most common clinical presentation and the usual basis for valve replacement or repair. Very straightforward. The patient presents with shortness of breath. The increased afterload finally causes cardiac decompensation. I'm not going to beat this to death, and it isn't a common test topic. Instead, here's where they get you. They use aortic stenosis as a baseline cardiac condition and superimpose atrial fibrillation treachery. In order to nail the derivatives, you first must identify AFib as the underlying rhythm. This was reviewed in the AFib video presented during the mitral stenosis series, but the take-home was to focus on the irregularity of the RR intervals. Insofar as the complications, the rapid heart rate impairs ventricular filling. Consequently, the preload, or LV end-diastolic volume, is decreased, leading to pulmonary venous congestion, or the clinical entity of congestive heart failure recognized by pulmonary edema. You must be facile with the role of preload in heart failure vignettes. The other related complication is that of ischemia. It is hard enough to perfuse the coronary vessels beyond the stenotic valve, but with the rapid heart rate, there is less time for the diastolic filling of those vessels with resultant angina or ischemia. They use a patient with aortic stenosis and rapid AFib just to make sure you know that coronary vessels fill during diastole. Pretty convoluted stuff. So as you can see from this discussion of the clinical signs and symptoms of aortic stenosis, they use this as a gateway condition to a number of loosely associated derivatives. But it all starts with your ability to correctly identify the murmur. Let's continue on to the pathology derivatives. So we need to be familiar with who gets aortic stenosis. And here are your players. There are really just two groups. The older patient with degeneration of the valve, complicated by dystrophic calcification, and the younger patient with the congenital bicusp. Insofar as dystrophic calcification, it is a ubiquitous term traveling across organ systems. The presence of dystrophic calcification is the hallmark of cell injury and death. This is core information in the principles of pathology. Be prepared for an aortic stenosis question where they describe an older patient diagnosed with either aortic stenosis or sclerosis. They will ask you the most likely pathologic process causing this finding. Answer, dystrophic calcification. Insofar as the congenital bicusp, same scenario. In this instance, however, a young patient described with an exam that is consistent with aortic stenosis. What is the pathologic process? Answer, congenital bicusp. It is worth appreciating the image on the right. We surely toss around the term bicusp, but what does it mean? It refers to fusion of the cusps resulting from incomplete commissural separation during development. The fused commissure is referred to as a RAFI. Do be aware that rheumatic fever can also cause aortic stenosis. Whereas mitral stenosis is certainly most characteristic, it does not hold a monopoly on valvular inflammation. Just maintain this awareness. The other key pathology derivative is the entity of concentric hypertrophy of the left ventricle. In the next two videos, we'll compare and contrast this entity with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and eccentric hypertrophy of aortic insufficiency. Suffice it to say, in concentric hypertrophy, compared with normal myocytes, we see thickening of the myocytes. The thickening or hypertrophy is described as taking place in parallel and is an adaptive response to the burden of increased afterload or wall stress. I include the wall stress formula of pressure times radius divided by 2 times the wall thickness. They won't ask, but it clarifies why and how a thicker wall translates into less stress. It is purely an adaptive response. We will return to concentric hypertrophy in subsequent videos. So just to bring it home, a stethoscope placed at the right upper sternal border, revealing a loud systolic murmur radiating up to the carotids, represents the gateway to a variety of derivatives reviewed in this video. Those materials are summarized in this slide, including demographic associations and a reiteration of the physical exam findings. From there, we went on to describe the hemodynamics, pathology, signs and symptoms of critical AS, as well as complications. In the next video, we'll pick up the discussion of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy before concluding the discussion of aortic valve disorders with a review of aortic insufficiency. If you have any questions or concerns about any of this material, please contact me at 12 Days in March. Thank you.